I get up, he started crying. Somebody misses me when I leave. Somebody. All right, it is the fourth Sunday night. Usually that means one of our men would be speaking, but Brent could not do so. He was scheduled. He told me that he may not be able to do it because all of his firefighter responsibilities and everything he's working with there. So I was prepared just in case. I'd rather hear him preach than me, so hopefully we can get him back as soon as his firefighter training and all that is finished and he gets back to a more normal routine. But I preach all the time, and so whenever I have to fill in on the fourth Sunday, and that's the time when the men usually do it, I try to do it a little bit differently, and I try to emulate those kinds of sermons. And the pattern that you find, even though it's a lot of different preachers, a lot of different speakers who speak on the fourth Sunday night, the one thing that they all kind of have in common is all the sermons have some clever hook to them, and they're always short and sweet and to the point. So I try to add both of those things this evening. We'll see if it works out that way. But this evening, what I wanted us to do, and I teased it this morning, was consider some ways in which Jesus is a plant. And that seems like such an odd thing. I understand it sounds odd, but when we break it down, hopefully, it will make sense. Which we have and we're going to look at are several metaphors. And your Bible is replete with metaphors that describe Jesus in a lot of different ways. And that's all that they are, just metaphors. For example, in John 10, Jesus is called the Good Shepherd. He's not really a shepherd, not by profession or anything else. But he describes himself as a shepherd in the sense that shepherds care for us. For example, in John 6, another one, he calls himself the living bread. Well, he's not really bread, but he is like bread in the sense that when we consume him, metaphorically speaking, we find a sustenance that gives us life everlasting. Over and over in the Bible, Jesus describes himself or is described by other people in the Bible as ways that compare him to plants. And I know that sounds like an odd thing, but like I said, as we go through them, I think they'll make a lot of sense. And we'll see them and thus see Jesus in a slightly different way. It's important sometimes to see Jesus as ways other than a man. And there's a time and a place to consider the humanity of Jesus. He was God in the flesh, but he was also a human being who came and lived and died and rose again. But all that set aside, there are other ways that you can talk about Jesus, other illustrations you can use, other metaphors, as we'll look at this evening, that describe Jesus. And as I said, I have four that we're going to look at this evening that compare him to plants. First of all, Jesus is a branch. Second of all, Jesus is a vine. Third, Jesus is a lily. And finally, we'll notice that Jesus is a rose. But to start with, let's notice that Jesus is a branch. Consider that Jesus is not just a branch like you think of the word, a limb that sticks out from a tree, but the word, as the Old Testament uses it, is a sprig, an uproot, a beginning of a growth of a plant. There are two verses in the Old Testament that I want us to read. They're behind me on the screen. The verse is Isaiah 11:1, where the prophet said, "There shall come forth a rod," the King James says, but the Bible you have might translate it as branch. "A rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch," there it is again, "shall grow out of his roots." That's Isaiah 11, verse 1. The other verse comes from Zechariah a few hundred years later, where he says, "Speak to him, saying, Thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, Behold, the man whose name is the branch. He shall grow up out of his place, and he shall build the temple of the Lord." Isaiah describes the Messiah, to go back to his verse, as a rod. The word means an upshoot. You plant a seed, and before too long, come spring, you see this little bitty twig, this little bitty beginning of what will grow into a mighty tree. That's the word translated as rod. And then later he says he is a branch. Doesn't mean a limb on a tree. That's an important distinction we'll get to in the second point. It just means, the word means, the beginning of a tree. And the roots from it grow out of the ground and begin to form a tree. Zechariah uses similar language later. He says Jesus is a branch who will build the temple of God, a spiritual house of relationship between God and man. Both times the word is used, the word branch describes something more than just a limb. It describes the tree itself. The point here is that Jesus grew from messianic roots. He's called in the verse of Isaiah, the rod from the stem of Jesse. Jesse being the father of David, the first of that seed line that would produce the Messiah. David, the second king of Israel, but through his seed line would come the Messiah, Jesus. Jesus came from that roots. The roots that grew came from, or produced rather, Jesus. So who is Jesus? He is the branch, the tree planted that bears Christian fruit. We have a little It's barely anything, but it's something. A little thing that we planted a couple of years ago in our backyard. I think, is it a peach tree? Plum tree. I didn't start with a P. It's a plum tree. We have yet to see a single solitary plum from that tree, but we have high hopes that one day it will eventually bear fruit. But we know once that little thing that's only about, well, about this tall, once it grows and it's able to bear fruit, we know what kind of fruit it's going to bear. It's going to bear plums. It's not going to bear peaches. It's not going to bear watermelon. It's not going to bear apples or pumpkins. It's going to produce only after its kind. It's going to bear the fruit that it's made to produce. My master is a tree, branch, the Old Testament word for it, and he produces fruit of a specific kind. Now, there are all kinds of people who claim Jesus as their roots, but they don't bear the same fruit. They don't exhibit the same fruit that Jesus says his tree will bear. A plum tree only produces plums. The Christian tree, the Christ tree, only produces Christians. And we can examine ourselves to the Word of God, and we can find that we are or are not the kinds of fruit that God wants us to be. There's all kinds of fruits and nuts out there. There's only one that comes from the tree of Jesus Christ. That's the first illustration, the first metaphor. The second one is a vine. So we have Isaiah and Zechariah. They were talking about Jesus, but what does Jesus say about himself? Look at John 15, verse 5. Or read it along with me there on the screen behind me. John 15, 5, Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. John 15, 5. The metaphor here changes. It's very different. Here, Jesus says he's the vine and we're the branches. In the Old Testament verses we just read, it said Jesus was the branch. And it's so ridiculous, but there are people who will criticize the Bible and will say there's a contradiction there, that Jesus is contradicting the prophecies talking about him because they said he'd be the branch. Well, Jesus said we'd be the branch. Well, you can't mix metaphors like that. It's not peanut butter and jelly. They don't go together. Those are two very distinct metaphors teaching very distinct things. Isaiah and Zechariah were talking about his upbringing and what he would do. His upbringing comes from Jesse, David. And what he would do is build a temple. He would be like a tree that grows these things. Whereas here, Jesus is talking about us. The emphasis is on us. He's the vine. We are the branches. We are the fruit that comes and springs off of this one particular vine. So your Bible's not wrong, like they say. Their common sense is wrong. They're missing the point. The answer comes when you look at the way the words are used. Jesus says that he is the vineyard that produces the grapes, and we're the grapes. And as I said in the previous metaphor, there's only one kind of fruit that's going to be produced by this vineyard, and we are that fruit. And if we don't match up with the description of that fruit in your New Testament, if we look at our lives and we don't measure up to the way that fruit coming from that vineyard is described, then there's a problem with us, not with the vine. Because the vine and the fruit that it produces, the grapes that come from this vineyard, are always good, right, and holy in his sight because he makes them that way. Many have misapplied Jesus' words here, especially in this text. There's a lot of man-made religions, man-created religious organizations who justify their existence and the existence of other man-made religions by using this verse. They say Jesus is the vine and all of these other man-made religions are the branches that stick off of it. But if you look at what Jesus said, he doesn't say organizations. He doesn't say groups. He doesn't say clubs. He says individuals. I am the vine, you are the branches. I don't need a middleman in my relationship with God. I don't need this man-made organization to bridge the gap between God and me. You say, well, what is the church? The church is me. I'm the church. You're the church if you're a Christian. The church, the word just means the called out of God, the individual saved people of God. He is the vine. We, the church, his church, written about and described in the New Testament, are the branches. We, the individual Christians, comprise the branches that make up the cluster in the vineyard of God. And people have misapplied Jesus' words and taught a lot of error, but he's very clear that he is the vine. We are the branches. Third illustration, he is a lily. And not just a lily, but he is, as we sang this morning, Greg led the song, the lily of the valley. Now this is a biblical description. It comes from Song of Solomon 2, verse 1. But we know this not necessarily from the verse. We know it from the song. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul, the lily. Not just the lily, but the lily of the valley, the particular kind of flower, the bright and morning star. All I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. Christians, when we read the Song of Solomon, we read it differently than the Jewish nation did when it was first written. They read it and they saw it on two levels, the love of Solomon for his wife, and then they saw it as an allegory for the love of God for Israel. Christians read it, and we see it on two levels too. We see it as a love for Solomon and his wife. We also see it as an allegory for the love between Christ and his church. When we examine Jesus, we see him as our beloved one. Just to give you a couple of verses, some of which we considered a few weeks ago, we talked about this. But Ephesians 5:25, Paul says, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it." Revelation 21:9, "There came unto me one of the seven angels with seven vials full of the last plagues and talked with me, saying, 'Come and I will show you the bride. I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife.'" Who is the Lamb of God? Jesus. Who is his bride? The saved of Jesus. We are the bride of Christ, and he loves us as much as we love him. Do you know what the distinguishing characteristic? Well, I had that on there, but I forgot to turn the page. Do you know what the distinguishing characteristic of the lily is? It's illustrated behind me. What visually is so striking about it, that beyond its pure white color, we think of lily white, but there's something else. It's the fact that the lily flower droops. It grows so tall that the bulb becomes heavier than the stalk that's holding it, and it sags down, especially when there's a rain or there's a lot of moisture in the atmosphere. It absorbs that moisture, becomes oversaturated, and droops down. My master is a lily of the valley. He rises above all of us, but he becomes so oversaturated with love that he droops down to our level so he can share that love with us. Isn't that a beautiful picture? So think about that the next time you sing that song. We sing it all the time. He's the lily of the valley. He's our lily, who droops down his great love for us. What a beautiful picture of Christ, the risen King. Last illustration, and then we'll be done. Who is Jesus? He is a rose. Not just any rose. He is the rose of Sharon. That comes from Song of Solomon 2, verse 1, where he says, "I am the rose of Sharon," Solomon does to his bride, the lily of the valley. But as I said, there's a connection there that we see with Christ and us. How do we see Christ? We see Jesus as a rose. But the interesting thing is, when you study the Rose of Sharon, this is a picture of the Sharon Valley. That's the Mediterranean Sea there in the Holy Land, so-called, of Jerusalem. The Valley of Sharon was located between the hills of Samaria and the Mediterranean Sea. So you can find that on your map and find a little valley where it's located. And all of these flowers, so many other flowers bloomed there, but the one that stood out, the one that became the most famous, was the so-called Rose of Sharon, which isn't even a rose, it's a tulip. But it's so beautiful and striking, and its red color just became known as the Rose of Sharon. But it's so beautiful, despite the fact there are so many other flowers around it that might grab your attention too, but you can't help but look at this one. And if you think about Jesus as a rose of Sharon, think about it like this. There are so many other things in this world that could attract your attention. But see Jesus as the rose that grabs your attention the most. See Jesus as that which you cannot take your eyes off of, that you cannot keep your attention away from. Don't let yourself be distracted by the other flowers that bloom. Find your rose of Sharon and keep your gaze set to him. The devil will offer you anything in this world to change your eyesight, to avert your gaze to what he can offer you. And he is the God of this world. He can offer you anything in this world. He can offer you the whole world, as he did to Jesus in Matthew 4. But you keep your eyes fixed on the beautiful rose of Sharon. And you may not see the short-sighted value in that, but the big picture is heaven itself. And there's no better reason to keep your eyes on Jesus than heaven itself. He is the rose of Sharon. And he calls for you to pluck him, to pick him, to make him your own. Will you choose Jesus this morning? Will you pluck him and make him part of your family? Make him your own. Make him your king. Who is he? He is the branch born from David's root. He is the vine that bears Christian fruit and only Christian fruit. He's the lily of the valley who stooped down to our level in order to save us. And he is the rose of Sharon, the fairest of them all. Will you become a Christian if you've not yet done so this evening? Obey the gospel by trusting and obeying. Listen to what Jesus says. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Do you believe Jesus will save you? Then obey his command, and he will do just that. Have you been a faithful Christian? Have you been faithful to Jesus as a Christian? If not, come back home. Repent of whatever sin is separating you from Christ, and Christ will forgive you. If you have any need, we want you to make it known this evening, because it may be your last opportunity. Let us know how we can help you right now as we stand and sing.